As a female who's been on the game for 15 years now, I've met loads of creeps, but only a few of them made me feel unsafe. To start off, I've always had a laptop since I was in high school. A luxury back then, I worked hard to earn enough to buy one. My mom almost took my money I earned for drugs, but luckily, money I made in tips were in cash, so it was easier to hide it from her. At first, my mom was mad I bought myself a laptop, but she soon forgot like everything. My dad could care less, and my older brother already had his own. So I started playing World of Warcraft with him at 14. And back then, girls were unheard of. So I got the usual creeps who usually backed off after hearing my age, or they were young too. But not this guy. This guy loved that I was underage. I was about 16, and used to creepy guys at this point, no longer a noob at the game or fending off the creeps. It was no surprise a new guy in the guild started hitting on me. Now, I was 16, dumb, young, horny, and stupid. But I knew I wasn't going to find love on World of Warcraft where you knew no one in real life. Plus, I had the ultimate crush on the guy I couldn't have, because he was my older brother's best friend. But in my mind back then, I only wanted him. So it was easy to turn guys down despite being desperate as hell for one guy. But that all changed after my brother's friend went off to college. I had a part-time job with my brother's friend, but girls at work surrounded him, and I became demoralized I'd never find love. Cute 19-year-old guy on World of Warcraft who made me feel wanted. I had a camera phone so I could send and post pictures at that age, and back then, I mostly used Facebook, MySpace, and PhotoBucket. I lost a lot of weight my sophomore year, so I posted confidently bikini pics and sexy pictures, thinking I lured the attention of my brother's friend whom was 19. So when this guy who was also 19 liked me, it didn't faze me. He looked the part in his photos, and his younger brother was my age, so I thought. He was extremely attractive in his photos, and even proved it was him in his pictures by holding items I asked for. He started playing my World of Warcraft subscription, which in the long run, I realized it was to get my home address and real name. I was so stupid and heartbroken over my brother's friend. Years of teaching myself online safety and the ability to be strong against flirts was all but lost in the fog. We talked for hours on Ventrilo, and he'd make me feel pretty. I was completely blinded by this point. He sent me gifts, and I didn't even question how he had my address. Then, he offered to drive and pick me up. As only then did I suddenly get cold feet. I had a good friend on Warcraft, someone my brother met at Penny Arcade Expo, and joined the guild and is still one of my best friends to this day. Though we both aren't fond of my older brother. He's 6 years older than me but never creeped on me. Was more like the protective brother I lacked. Well, at least till I was 24 and single for the first time that we hook up. But that's because we were friends for so long. But the distance led to it not turning into a relationship. He caught on to it through conversation and was my words of wisdom in a time I was lacking any of my own. He saw something was fishy when I couldn't. I told my friend I was scared to meet him because, dumb teenager logic, I thought he would not like me. My friend chimed in that I shouldn't meet anyone off the internet at my age. I told him about the gifts, and I swear I've never been scolded like this in my life. Not even by my own parents. But he always cared like that. He wondered why I would give my address to someone I never met. And the expensive gifts I got were not something the average 19-year-old could afford. None of this ever clicked for me, of course, because I was lonely and trying to prove, I don't know, to myself, my crush or something, that I could get a boyfriend. Like that, I told the guy it wasn't wise to meet in person and my parents said I wasn't allowed to. That's when it went dark. At first, it was pestering over and over, guilting me over gifts he gave me and encouraging me to defy my parents. While he kept bothering me, it never once occurred to me he'd lose his shit. While my friend was worried shitless about the guy having my address, going as far as to drive the 11 hours to my house and explain the situation to my dad, as I refused to tell him out of fear of getting into trouble at the time. All the while, taking a spring break in my state instead of his own and his friends. There's a reason he's still one of my best friends. He has a little sister of his own as well, and she's my age, so his protective nature is natural. Eventually, he made me block the guy, and that was that. This guy was pissed off. He'd go on different accounts to accuse me of gold digging and using him. Luckily, my friend was smart enough and had the foresight to change my World of Warcraft password, and even paid for my account for me taking this guy off it entirely, as one of this guy's threat was to delete my account. But it didn't end there. It got worse as he'd consistently find ways to message me and tell me how terrible I was. Till about a month had passed. I was walking home from school, about 2 mile walk in the wealthy suburbs of New England, which I had done for years. Many kids did, as it was a very safe town with no crime in it or surrounding towns. Without a second thought, I took off with my 100-pound backpack. Maybe an overestimate, lol. Plugged my headphones in and started my 20-minute walk home. It was cold, and I had earmuffs over my headphones, only drowning out more sound too. I swear, if I could talk to myself as a kid, I probably just slapped myself for stupidity. Because Warcraft guy knew I walked home every day as I talked about it. He knew my address, and I never thought twice. I was on the back roads walking home, and honestly, easy to map from my school to home as it was pretty straightforward with only one turn. At halfway home, in between songs, I heard a vague crunching sound of tires rolling over gravel on the road slowly. I turned around to see a tinted black car that you couldn't see much of the person in front. I jogged out of the driveway I was standing in front of, assuming it was waiting to turn in. But it didn't turn. The roads were dead, and it didn't make sense for him not to go around. I swear, the saying that you go cold when you're terrified is absolutely true. It could have been a summer's day at 95 degrees and my bones would have been cold. My heart just sank, and my breathing was uncontrollable. It felt like I had no control over my body as I realized this guy was following me. My blood truly ran cold, and my hands shook as tears formed and my skin felt tight. My body felt like it wasn't ready to fight or flight, but simply freeze there and die. It only got worse as the second time I turned my head to see the car stop. I stopped. My world stopped. I couldn't stop staring. Just froze, and breathing like all my school books were on my chest, crying silently. My eyes hurt with no tears or sound as I just stood there. The door opened after what felt like hours, but only seconds, maybe a minute, and it was in fact him. It was the attractive guy from the photos. Not a catfish, but something seemed different. At first, I thought it was his angry expression, but soon realized he was definitely not 19, more like 30 plus. I could barely think over the loud sound of my heart racing as it froze me in place. I thought I was about to throw up as he spoke to me, told me to get in the car or he'd light my house on fire and kill my dog in front of me. I honestly just couldn't move, couldn't reach for my phone, as his words just froze me. And like some magic we both failed to notice, there's a little old lady on her porch watching this play out. Suddenly, I hear her yell,
"Get away from that girl right now before I burn you alive."
We both turn to meet her eyes. Pissed off small lady about 60 or 70 with white hair. I think she noticed my frozen and fear state as she told me to get over to her quickly. Like that, I ran over to her, tossing off my heavy brick of a backpack. It was obvious he was unsure what to do next, as he stood there and watched me run to her. Must have been the sight this tiny thin old lady standing in front of a teenage girl yelling at this man to go away. Like that, Savior number 2 joined the battle as her husband stepped out. A guy who looked like he'd been through a war or two, with a shotgun of all things and a booming voice, gun pointed, saying,
"I've shot and killed men for less reason. You better leave now."
He got into his car and drove off as I simply collapsed. All that fear just came out as I cried harder and harder, as my brain sifted through the past few months of mistakes. After calming me down enough to speak in a non-hyperventilating words, she asked me if I knew him. I told her, kind of, but only online from a video game, not real life. Of course, explaining it wasn't easy. And her husband couldn't grasp why I wanted printed I was at war. I'm sure in his experience, he was thinking Call of Duty, not magical creatures in a game called World of Warcraft. She got on the phone with the school counselor, her daughter apparently, and told her my name. I was well known to her daughter, ironically, but it was only 250 or less kids in the school, and the town itself was small. Many staff at our school had family in town. Kids at school, they were related to either by their own children or their siblings' children. It was the kind of town if you didn't leave by a certain age, you were stuck there. So honestly, it seems ironic, but entirely not a huge surprise. The counselor was well aware of my family and my mom's drug addiction, as child services had been involved a few times. She came by in 10 minutes to pick me up and asked me a ton of questions, of course, knowing I didn't want to involve police as I was scared of being taken away from my parents again. For your information, foster care was worse than a drugged out mom on prescriptions. We weren't rich, but we were more well off than many. Though my mom worked, my dad kept my mom on a tight budget to keep her from buying prescriptions from Canada she wasn't prescribed, hence her trying to take my money. She knew all of this, and knew though rough, I was better off than foster care, which was a gamble with losing odds at best. Plus, 2 more years, and I'd be off to college anyway, so we didn't involve the cops. But she made me promise to take the bus every day, and to inform my dad of the situation. She also called my dad at work to inform him, and had a teacher make sure I got on the bus every day till I graduated even. Really sucked, but I understood. If it ended there, it would be nice. But there's still a bit more, and I'm sorry for the length and grammar. It's late at night, and I'm recalling from memory and typing on my phone. 2 days after this, my dad had to fly out for business. My brother was off at college, so it left me and my high mom, who promised my dad should stay sober while he was gone. But I was used to helping her while she was high. It was like taking care of a child. But I was on edge as ever. Creak in that big house from the 60s, cats stir at night, and dog barking outside set me on edge. I barely slept. My friend on Warcraft called every night making sure I was okay for the past month. I lived in the middle of the woods, next to a huge river in my backyard, so there was still a lot of wildlife outside in the dead silence of the cold months. Running water is an important source of water when lakes froze. I had been used to all the bumps in the night, cats coming and going,
and dog barking at every animal in the yard. But it all seemed new to me as I laid in bed trying to drown out my fears. The house I grew up in was a 6-bedroom house. I had a little sister too, but she stayed with my grandma in another state per court order while I was allowed to choose due to her only being 9 and me 16. The other rooms were used as a game room, office for my dad, and guest room mostly for when my sister visited my grandma and her had a room. So, in a large house like that in the middle of the woods, it was scary to virtually be alone because my mom accounted for defenseless. I was letting my last cat inside for the night. 5 cats who all knew to come in at night for dinner and stayed in till morning. And at the end of the long driveway between my neighbor and our house was parked a black car. I quickly shut the door and locked it after my cat got inside. I made sure all 5 doors were locked and even put cardboard on the glass doors to the pool. I don't know, hoping if he broke them it would delay him if that car was his. I went and turned off all the lights and got all my cats into one room so I knew they were safe. Here's the thing about my dog. He's untrained for the most part, but was basically a giant lab puppy in his mind. But he growled at strangers, not barked like at animals. We had to keep him outside if we had guests, but he never bit anyone, and if you spent enough time around him, he'd eventually accept you. Also, he didn't growl at all strangers either, so he wasn't the most reliable guard dog either. But he was big and half a deep bark. I mulled over what to do as I sat there in the dark with my dog, waiting for Shadow to pass by the window. I eventually went upstairs to my mom's room and woke her up from her sleeping pill slumber. Groggy and still kinda high, she didn't quite grasp what I was telling her till I started crying. She sorta sobered up and asked me to get her some coffee and I did. All while I'm watching my dog's every move because I know he could sense something before I did. As my mom sobered, her fear in her eyes grew. Eventually, she got the idea to call my neighbors and ask them if they knew the car. After all of them said no, 2 of the men went out of their house to check on the car together. The car was empty. At closer inspection though, they noticed it was a newer car. It's a Lexus, and in the passenger seat was a laptop. The car was locked, but with a flashlight you could see somewhat into the tinted windows. They never told us why, but something they saw in the car prompted them to call the local sheriff. Only one, and he lived in town sort of thing. We were too small to have a police department. He drove over about 15 minutes later, ran the plates, and asked the houses around about it. Apparently, it was a rental car from Ohio, and he was calling to see who it was rented to, but the offices were closed, I think. He stuck around in his car for about an hour, till someone came out of the woods, and ran back in as the cop turned his spotlight on him. I couldn't see what he was pointing at with his light, as it was at the side of my house, and I was looking at the front. I guess he called for backup as 3 other cop cars showed up in 5 minutes of it from the neighboring town, highway patrol, I don't know. At which, a lady cop got out as I asked to speak with her, and her calling my counselor at school to explain who that might be. I was pretty shy back then, but I don't know, something about a female cop made me feel more comfortable to open up to. I told her the gist of the story. Then she called my counselor who backed up my story, but also explaining why I was scared of cops, cause my history with foster care and not wanting to go back. At which, a mostly sober mom joined me, hugging me, doing her typical apologetic routine, but also offering much needed comfort as she called my dad too. Eventually, the lady cop asked if she could take a look around the house to see if things were secure and get any information from my laptop about him. In her search, she found something I didn't think about checking. The basement door was not just unlocked, but open. It's never unlocked, so I didn't even think to check it as our backyard floods in the spring due to beaver dams, and it's got extra seals and stuff to prevent the basement from flooding. Again, but the stuff sealing it, which was mostly sandbags and stuff, were set aside. But the doors at the bottom of the stairs was locked. Still though, it had some damages on it, like someone tried to pick it. But he had access to half of the basement that was storage. Our basement was sectioned, and the other half used to be used for my brother's parties. The door between the sections was like a front door, not an indoor door, as in the summer my dad left the hatch open to dry out the basement and adjust pool settings, as it was basically a pool house, and the cats loved it, so it also had a few cat beds. The section that led upstairs was locked from the inside, and the wall and door were not drywall and cheap door either, but a keyed and heavily locked door and a bricked wall. Upon noticing that, my dad confirmed he had not left it open. My suspicions that black car was his was pretty much confirmed. As we walked through the house to make sure everything was still safe, she got on my laptop as they searched the woods. I gave her everything I had, his photos, username, and she even checked to see if his credit card was still on my account. It wasn't, but the last few digits were. She then asked to take my laptop for a few days as she thought she could get some good evidence from it. I asked her to please not damage it and return it as soon as possible because I used it a lot. Before smartphones, it was all I had. After a few hours, onlooking neighbors had gone to bed. The cops came back empty-handed, but left the cop outside our house and towed the guy's car. From what the lady cop told me, what permitted such fear was in the car. There was two guns, some sort of rope, and handcuffs. And the guy who ran back into the dense woods was wearing a winter ski mask. Not out of season, but suspicious nonetheless. So, eventually, I try and lay down and go to sleep. But pretty sure I was going to call out sick tomorrow, and kept all my cats inside for the day. I was too restless to sleep. Every sound scared me. My mom slept with the dog in her room. I'm very allergic to animals, but less to cats, as I'm kind of built up a tolerance to cats, but not dogs. And my cat slept in my room most nights, by choice, as my room was usually the warmest. At 3:30 in the morning-ish, I heard a knock at the back door, and a guy says,
"Undercover police officer, open up."
I was still awake as I walked downstairs to make out a guy standing in the dark with a gun. As he saw me, he demanded I let him in now as he needed to speak with me. Something felt off. My gut knew it before I did that this guy's voice seemed forced. Like someone purposely making their voice deeper. And why was he at the back door? So I turned on the light outside, and sure enough, it was him. I just screamed as quickly. As I screamed, he started hitting the door hard. Wasn't a very loud horror movie scream, but more like a gasp. I don't think the fear in my body had a loud scream to let out, but the banging was pretty loud. As I ran to the front to see if the officer was still outside. He was, but he wasn't getting out of his car. I didn't want to run outside as I'm not a fast runner. So I turned the porch lights on and off a couple of times, but still nothing. After a minute, my dog came bolting down to the door, barking and growling, nearly foaming at the mouth. Soon followed my mom, who yelled she had a gun. She didn't, but bluff is a bluff. Somehow during all of this, the cop outside had snuck around back and had his gun pointed at him, yelling to put his gun down. I hid as the rest went down, but he was arrested. No trial needed for me to attend, and my statement was enough. I come to find out that he wasn't even American. The car was rented under his friend's name, and after all was done,
he was deported back to Canada. I assume something with his passport would prevent him from coming back to the US, as the cop reassured me he couldn't come back to the US now. I don't know what exactly he was charged with, but I think my dad said activated assault with a deadly weapon, attempted kidnapping, and something else. And also, it turned out he was 32 years old, not 19. So I assume me being a minor carried a charge. And life moved on from there. I had plenty of creeps before and after, but he was by far the worst from Warcraft. I had a couple of them from streaming too, but I was an adult and much better at staying safe online. The only thing worse than this guy was my ex-boyfriend's cousin, who made my life hell for a couple of years. But that's a story for another time. And that's the end of the story. Wow, OP, this story keeps escalating. This guy was a crazy stalker, and we don't even know what he truly wants from you. But let's not dig too deep, as some things are better off left unknown. The internet has brought incredible experience for people nowadays. It is the age where knowledge and info can be found with a simple search on the browser. But let's not forget that this also applies to those people with bad intentions as well. Be very careful on what info you put on your profile. Do not give out info that is too personal. And especially, do not trust people whom you just met, as you don't know what their true intentions were. This true story is posted by user Cat Religion. If you like this story, do go and show your support to them by giving them the upvote, link in the description. And to those that are still listening, this content is free to play on YouTube, but it does take hours to record this one story alone, and that doesn't even include video making. So just a simple subscribe to my channel will help me a lot. It's free, so don't worry. So yeah, everyone, stay safe, have a great night, and we'll see you again next time.